I am Bob Parks, the Executive Director of the International Dark Sky Association, also the founder of the Almost Heaven Star Party. And this is my first time back in 3 years, so I'm pretty happy. Unfortunately, for the last three, this coincided with the European Symposium for IDA, which made it a little difficult for me to attend. IDA has made a lot of changes in the last few years. Our focus recently has become parks and protected areas. We've always had something called the International Dark Sky Places, which is a program to preserve the dark spots that are still left. And we started this program over a dozen years ago. We now have 24 in locations as diverse as bridges, natural bridges, state park or national park in Utah. And our most recent one is in Namibia, Africa. And most recently before that, we have another one in Scotland, Wales. We've really become international. More of our international dark sky places are overseas now than they are in the United States. And part of what we've decided to do is to help these parks become dark sky parks. And there's quite a rigorous process involved. Not only do you have to be dark, you have to have a commitment to remaining dark, which means you have to have some sort of lighting management plan in effect that will keep it dark in a road. And that can be very challenging because most of the light pollution that affects these areas isn't from within the park, it's from the surrounding area. In many cases, you have gateway communities which have sprung up around national parks, and they are loving the parks to death. They are treating them as if they're the cash cow that they are, and building lights that are not exactly dark sky friendly or going up with them. So in many cases, the work of a national park or protected area is to spend a lot of time talking to the neighbors and trying to get the communities to agree that they need to protect the resources, actually drawing a lot of their tourists. So we've been expanding the program into what's called the Park and Protected Areas Program, and that is our staff working with the national parks and the areas that want to become IDSPs and giving them technical assistance. For instance, I just came back from Bryce Canyon, which is a prospective park, and we spent 3 or 4 days retrofitting the lighting around their visitor center, which was particularly hard. And they are now well on the way to being able to do the rest of the retrofits themselves. And then when they are ready, we will help them with the application. And the application is difficult because you have to have these agreements with the localities around you. You have to have retrofitted over 80% of their lighting within the park to be dark sky friendly. We can talk about what that is. For 25 years, next year, IDA has been promoting quality outdoor lighting. Quality outdoor lighting, at its basic, is fully shielded lighting. And whenever you have a light, crude representation. Let me put a really nasty demonstration. If this was an unshielded light and it was like a typical street light, what you see when you look at it when you're driving or walking is called glare. And I really should have grabbed a nastier light before I started this. So vision is an interesting thing. We use light to increase our visibility. In the dark, we don't see as well as we do during the day. So for many, many years, inside, we've always put shades over the lights because we didn't like staring at them. And they decrease visibility because as soon as you've looked at this, you don't see what you want to see as well. When you shield this, all the light goes down on the surface that you want to see. And this increases visibility. Unfortunately, for the last 50 years, highway engineers haven't figured this out. So a lot of lights as you drive down the road are either partially shielded or unshielded. If you go downtown to Washington, D.C., you will see what's called acorn lights. Acorn lights are just big plexiglass acrylic domes on top of an unshielded light. And the reason people use them is they look really nice during the day. They look like glass, and they look colonial. And all that makes the historic preservation people happy, so they recommend that they use them. Unfortunately, at night, when you're driving down the road, the lights in them are about 100 times brighter than this. And as you're walking or driving, if you happen to look up, you will see significant glare. And what you won't see is what's underneath the light or what's on the road as well, because visibility requires that light not be in your eyes. In fact, if the light goes in your eyes, you now need 5 to 10 times more light to counteract the glare, because the glare is causing your eyes to adapt to a brighter light like during the day, and they're also shutting down. The iris is shutting down. So the combination requires you to have a much brighter light source, which is counterintuitive because there's no end to it. As you increase the brightness, you need more brightness to see the same. So IDA started about 25 years ago primarily promoting fully shielded lighting. And fully shielded lighting is as simple as having the light source completely inside of the shield so that you can't see it when it's mounted. You can see it underneath, obviously, but no light emitted above the horizontal plane. And so this shield serves that purpose. And it also directs the light much more efficiently to the ground, which means you need a lot less light. When you put an unshielded fixture up, you probably need 4 to 5 times more light, which is inefficient. So IDA started the process 25 years ago, educating individuals who wanted to change lighting in their community as well as communities. And we spent a lot of time working directly with counties and cities to develop their own lighting ordinances. And the first step in a lighting ordinance is to shield the lights. The second is to consider where you put a light. Do you actually need it? There's a lot of highways and roadways that are lit just because it was money to light them. And that was the only reason. There is no criteria that says you have to light a rural highway to see better, because in most cases, you don't see as well. When you put up unshielded lights or partially shielded lights, and you're in a darkened environment, and you're driving down the road, that light is what's going to, you're going to focus and your adaptation is going to change, and you're less likely to be able to see what's on the other side of that light than you would be with your headlights, which are always on and focused away from you. So we work with state highway administrations and the federal government trying to do something called warranting, which is deciding when you need lights. We estimate that if there was reasonable warranting in place, you could eliminate 50% of the outdoor lighting in the country tomorrow. And that doesn't mean you'd be any less safe or you wouldn't be able to see as well. You would just be eliminating light that does not serve a useful function and doesn't help you. It doesn't increase your visibility. It's a real long uphill battle because people love light. People love light for a number of reasons, but mainly because when we were in the caves, we huddled around light because it made us feel safe. And in fact, in those days, it made you safe. You were less likely to be hauled off by a saber-toothed tiger if you were around a fire. But this has been almost ingrained in our DNA. So, you know, a few millennia later, we still think that light makes us safer. And that is why we put up so much. If it wasn't for people clamoring for more lighting, a lot of lights would not be put up. What we need to do is educate that some light actually does improve safety, does improve visibility, and some light just makes us feel safer. And is light that just makes us feel safer worth putting in? Because never before have we come to a conjunction of what the cost of lighting the environment is actually costing us. It's not just money, because we would estimate over $3 billion in the U.S. alone could be saved by just shielding and putting up proper lights as opposed to unshielded lights. We estimate that that's about 50 coal-fired power plants required to generate the energy that's being wasted by that light. And that means you have air pollution, but you also have CO2. So you have a lot of factors that in the old days nobody cared about, and now we have some sort of activity.
You're a bear.
A bear? Okay. So we now have to think about the negative consequences of outdoor lighting. It's just not as easy. You can't just throw it up and think you've made great improvements in society. You actually may be causing more damage. So the IDA has now started taking on, like I'm saying, we're not just working with cities and towns and the federal government. We're also now trying to work really hard to preserve those areas for the future, kind of on a parallel path with the National Park Service. It was founded over 100 years ago to preserve the wilderness, because at that point everybody knew the wilderness was going to disappear. Well, up until about 100 years ago, everything had dark skies. You could be everywhere except the major metropolitan area and you could see the Milky Way. 50 years ago, in most major cities, you could have seen the Milky Way from right outside the city. In the last 50 years, that's just not the case. Most areas in the last 50 years have gone out of control. The development has driven it, but just the desire for more lights has really changed the landscape of the world, not just the United States, but the United States has been a leader in light pollution, we can be really proud to say. And what we need to do now is look at the next 100 years and say, is this what we want for our children? Is this the world they deserve? Because we didn't grow up, we, the old generation like myself, didn't grow up with this. But we kind of decided that it wasn't important enough to save. So for the last 50 years, we've been putting up lights like there is no tomorrow. And it has caused more light pollution and the inability to see. You guys know from Northern Virginia what you can see. I've done outreach on the Washington Monument grounds, and on a good night, I got to see a dozen stars. And actually, a couple of them are probably planets, so it doesn't count. It's not just major cities. You can go to small towns now, and they are, you know, just working their way towards being big towns, and they figure putting up more lights makes them look big, and it makes their citizens feel safer. So the IDA's mission for the next 25 years is simple, and it's lumens are what, it's a measurement of the light that comes out of a fixture. So if you have a lumen, you have a 1,000 lumen fixture, and you make it 2,000 lumens, you've doubled the output of that fixture. And the more light you put into the environment, the more that is going to end up in the sky, and more waste. So the mission of the IDA for the next 25 years is to reduce the total lumens in the environment. And that is going to be tough because it is going up at a rate of about 8 to 10% every year. And so to just stop and reverse that is a lot of work. So we have to start on the big picture. The big picture, as I'm saying, is municipal lighting. It's roadway lighting. It's street lighting. That accounts for over 60% of outdoor lighting in the United States and the world. And if we can finally get some federal, you know, leadership to make this part of an energy conservation effort, it might happen. But as you know, not much is happening downtown these days. So that's really what I wanted to do, is give you an overview of what IDA does, what quality outdoor lighting is, and then ask if anybody's got any questions, and then I can demonstrate some of the things we're doing with the National Park Service, the way we've been developing. We've been part of what they call a cooperative agreement with the National Park Service for the last 2 years, and that's basically a grant where we're giving them our expertise and working within the National Park Service to develop new standards and retrofit their lights. And in the process, we're improving the quality of their lighting and reducing pollution, light pollution in the national park so that they can, in turn, become a international dark sky place if they want to. So,
I want to ask you, I was on the website maybe a couple weeks back, Bob, and looking at like homeowner associations and some of the smaller things. And you've talked about parks, and I think, you know, those are really important for us to protect the skies in those areas. And you mentioned reversing. Now, I happen to live close to Burke, and I noticed your daughter had a Burke shirt on today. So I'm assuming you live over that way.
Fairfax Station.
So you're not far from the Conservancy. And you know that when those areas were founded, they were founded on the principles of conserving something while they were doing it, but they didn't really know what they were doing.
Sure.
So I live right across from Target there, and I watched them put up these big acorn lights right across the street. And they look great, and they're really bright, but they're ridiculous for observing.
Looking great
is
something else.
And so I know that in my homeowners association, and I noticed some documentation about how to, you know, sort of try to get homeowners association, so grassroots wise, I just wonder if you would maybe speak about that for a minute.
Sure. That's what we try to do, is to provide resources to individuals to allow them to talk to their communities, because the biggest thing IDEA has had to overcome and still has to overcome is just ignorance. It's a total lack of awareness, and I'm not being facetious when I say among lighting professionals as well. I mean, when you have roadway Virginia Department of Transportation folks that have never had an hour of instruction in lighting design, have no idea what improves visibility, but they're making the decisions to light, you know, hundreds of miles of highway. And then the same thing goes for like Fairfax City. 4 or 5 years ago, we had the gentleman from the lighting department of Fairfax City attend one of our meetings, and he was, you know, all taking notes and eager and, you know, going through this, and we want to do as good as we possibly can do. And I said, well, are you planning to do more lighting? And he goes, oh yeah, we're going to light the entire
Main Street
there. And I said, really? Why? Well, I mean, you know, people, you know, need to know there's a building. I said, you haven't had the light for 90 years? I mean, what needs more light at this point? First of all, if you've ever been down, half of it doesn't have sidewalks. It doesn't have anything for the pedestrians. So rather than put, you know, money in sidewalks and making it pedestrian friendly, you're going to light it. And then he goes, yeah, well, you know, everybody wants to put in these, you know, these acorn lights because they, you know, they think they look pretty. And I said, well, you know, you're trying to do two different things. Okay, you say you're trying to improve lighting, and then you want to put in lighting that will basically make it more difficult to see. So the combination seemed like a bad way to go. Can I come and talk to your head staff and give you some reasons why you might want to consider alternatives to that? Oh no, we've already worked on it. We were the really good ones though. These are the, you know, the 150 watt metal halide. I mean, you know, yeah, great. And so in a matter of, you know, 2 or 3 months after that, they installed 500 just terrible lights. And what's really frustrating is that I had worked for 7 years with the Fairfax County to make sure that that doesn't happen. Unfortunately, Fairfax City is not part of Fairfax County. So right in the middle of Fairfax County, you can do whatever you want. And that's part of the problem. Is that, you know, you find it on a local level, but
right. We see like during certain times, like in Fairfax, for example, that they've put up the big road lights. Like even off, you know, Guinea Road or Roberts Road, some areas are well lit where they have those big highway type lights, the big
highlight.
High mast?
Yeah, the high mast lights.
Yeah.
And they just seemed like there was a period of time where they were just putting those up like nobody's business for no reason at all.
Unfortunately, and I think we're almost responsible for that. I mean, sometimes, like I tell you, unintended consequences are a bitch.
Right.
Because we worked 7 years ago with Richmond and Virginia to pass what's basically was a procurement action that forced the state to purchase cutoff lighting. We didn't get full cutoff. We started there and we got it back to cutoff lighting. Well, at that time, VDOT was putting up an awful lot of unshielded, really bad lighting there. If you go down, that's lighting. It's Fairfax County Parkway right before you get to 66.
That was
the epitome of the stupidity of the VDOT folks, where they decided to cut down the amount of lights. They just put the lights on 45 degree angles. And so they have lights that were designed to go like this, and they just pointed them up 45 degrees and shot them across, you know, four lanes. And that made it cheaper to do bad lighting, and that really was the focus of VDOT at that point, is how cheaply can we do this lighting? And so what happened when we passed this law, which is about 7 years ago, is it required them to start using full cutoff and cutoff lighting. So high mast lighting is full cutoff lighting. It's monstrously inefficient because the poles are 100 feet plus in the air and they put out so much light that it hits the atmosphere, bounces up. It really does not improve the situation. But for the last 7 or 8 years, that's been their go-to fixture. So you see them popping up on every major road. So once again, I mean, it's really hard to control bad lighting. I mean, unless you're involved in each design, people are going to do things that make sense to them and they don't necessarily work well. But getting back to your point, to go to a local community, we find it really helpful to just get on their speaker list, because typically they will have a monthly meeting where they can't find enough people to talk. And when you sign up, just tell them that you want to talk to them about quality outdoor lighting, and you bring some props, and you bring some slides, and I can guarantee you 80% of the room will have never heard or seen anything that you'll talk about. It'll be alien territory for them. And the more people that know and can then tell other people, that's how we change our awareness from 10% to getting up to the point where you have an even shot that somebody understands the problem, you might be able to get it fixed. So from that point of view, if you need help, if you need slides, if you need props, let me know, because I'm in your neighborhood, I can come by and help.
Our lights in our neighborhood are like really old.
Yeah.
And so I'm thinking eventually they're going to want to do what they did across the street, which is the UJ corner, and I want to stop that from happening.
Well, the good and bad news is we are in what I would call a once in a century in this situation, transformation of outdoor lighting. It happens typically every 50 years, but we're going to do something in the next 10 that will probably last in general technology for maybe another 100 years. And it's called solid state lighting. And solid state lighting is what I'm going to show you here. It's a whole new ballgame. It's mostly more efficient than what has been used in the past. And it's a game changer because in a time where budgets are shrinking and electricity bills are going up, municipalities are going to be able to figure out pretty quickly that the return on investment might be less than 10 years to retrofit all their outdoor lighting. And after that point, they'll be saving money and putting it in the bank every year. And that will change a lot of people's minds about outdoor lighting. The good and bad news is some of that LED, primarily SSL, solid state lighting, a lot of different technologies, but the most popular is LED. When they do that, they'll either put in bad lights, like the lights they have, to replace what they've got that just happen to be a little more efficient, or they have the opportunity to change the way they light. And the way they light, meaning, first of all, figuring out how much light do you need. Do you actually need light? Do you need it all the time? Because in the old days, you had to light dusk to dawn. The technology was designed to turn on. It took 20 minutes to heat up and get up to full brightness. So you didn't dim it, you didn't turn it off. You just put a sensor on for a photo and it came on and went off. You can now, and we are promoting heavily, the idea that lighting for periods of activity. So if somebody, you know, if you're going to light a sidewalk, a crosswalk, a city street, you light it because there's traffic. You light it because there's pedestrians. Typically, that goes way downhill after rush hour. So maybe you have full brightness up until 8 or 9 o'clock. You dim it down 50% after. Then at midnight, turn it off, or if you need the security blanket, leave it on 20% so people feel safe, but you're not spending 100% of the energy. That is another way to reduce total lumens in the environment. If you can reduce the amount of hours it's on or the brightness it's on, then that would be one of the best ways to approach it. The fact that if you have old lights, you probably have one or two options. Really old lights, mercury vapor lights, are actually now outlawed. Mercury vapor lamps won't be sold after the end of the decade, and you can't buy new ones now. You can't buy new fixtures. So if they are there, they will be replaced within 2 years of the end of the decade, because that's the length of the lamp that's going to, if they put them in at the end, they're not going to last much longer than that. But if they've been in the last 20 years, they're probably high pressure sodium, pinkish. And those happen to be really efficient. I mean, this is the trick. Right now, they're as efficient as most LED lighting. 2 years from now, that won't be the case, because LED is getting much more efficient much quicker. So everybody will be changing their lights in the next decade. I would estimate 50% of outdoor lighting will be retrofitted to LED in the next decade. So this transition has never happened where 50% of the technology is going to be changed, or 50% of the installed base will be changed in a very short period of time. Historically, we've gone from candlelight to electric light of very low intensity with incandescent light. And then every technology that's come through has vastly increased energy efficiency. The most recent big change was mercury vapor, which was the first high intensity discharge lamps. It's a gas lamp. Very, very bright, very, very efficient. Mercury was kind of greenish, and then they went to high pressure sodium, which was kind of pinkish. And every time we've had an opportunity to maintain the lighting level that we had and save a lot of energy, we decided to make everything brighter. And we left the energy savings on the table. We do this consistently. People want to have it brighter. I mean, that just has been the drive for the last 50 years. This time, we have a unique situation in that LED is very expensive compared to everything else. To put in the same traffic light, or the same roadway light that you pay $250 for today, costs about $1,000. So people are starting to think, well, maybe I don't need that much light. Maybe I can get by with something half that bright. And they're putting them in, and they're actually way more light than they need. So people are starting to realize that they've been overlighting. But when they do that, they're actually going to save a lot of energy. We'd like them to put the right amount of light in instead of two or three times, but half of what they were doing at six or seven times is really pretty good. So what I'm getting back to is that your community and a lot of municipalities will relight, and the more information we can get in front of them to say, you don't have to light as bright and you don't have to light as often, is going to make a big difference in the world.
Does the IDA website or maybe a YouTube video, is there something out there that is basically the speech you just gave? So that would be, because I had never heard of this before, and that simple concept that more light is not necessarily going to improve visibility.
Or safety.
I think that's an easy...
That's the problem.
That would be an easy message to get out. That something like to post on Facebook or something, just to
we
get
have a really active Facebook.
Are there easy references out there that
that people could read a little frequently asked question just to get that.
Actually, that inside the website, the best thing is called a practical guide. Mm-hmm. And it is, we have a series of practical guides, which some are intended for homeowners, some are intended for city officials. And the first practical guide on the list is just a general how to what is light pollution and how can you avoid it. And I wish I would have brought some that I can show you on the website. Those are really good. I know that our Facebook and our Twitter is primarily driven around events as opposed to general information, but we do feed back to the website on a regular basis trying to give people answers. We have the unfortunate situation that we have way too much stuff on our website. We have accumulated over many years an awful lot of stuff, and keeping it organized in a way that people tell me all the time, I can't find what I'm looking for. And I've had the same situation sometimes, because to try to simplify the navigation, we don't have 50 tabs. We basically have 5 or 6 tabs, and you do have to drill down a little bit to figure out which one's which. But all that would be under resources. That's the most commonly visited area. That has all of our general information. And it has a lot of good video clips, video face from talks and people. Yeah.
The acorn lights, are they the ones about the size of a basketball? Look nice and white?
They look like this.
They're called sticky.
They're actually, the technical term is the Washington globe. And it's been the most popular streetlight fixture in Washington, D.C. since it was made out of glass, which was 50 years ago, before they turned to cheap Chinese plastic junk, which is our biggest problem, is they're very cheap. They cost about $250, which is the same as a Cobra, you know, the old-fashioned lights. And they just put out, talk about energy efficiency. If you have something like this, what we talked about before, okay, say that's your street light, or say it's a Russian globe and it's like this. The really hard part of a fixture that's mounted like this is that you're going to have stuff underneath of it. In the case of a Russian globe, it's a big base with a hole. And what that does is effectively block all the light from going down underneath the fixture where you thought you wanted it. So you can effectively, if you want to be a criminal, find one of these things and hide underneath it. Because unless there's a lot of other light, you won't notice that person until you walk by them. Because they cast such a direct shadow underneath them. Mm-hmm. So where we would hope all the light's going down, you're not getting any light. And what you're also getting is at least 50% of the light is going above the horizon, which means you're lighting the belly of birds. I mean, it is doing absolutely nothing for visibility. And if you like putting it in an acrylic dome and it looks pretty, what I tell people is, put something like this in it. Not 150-watt high-pressure sodium light. Because it's not a lighting fixture designed for visibility. It's a decorative fixture. In fact, if you really want to make it perfect, that's a 1-watt LED. That's about the equivalent of the candle that used to be in the historic type fixture that this thing's trying to copy. And that shows you why you had acrylic or glass lenses in the old days, is you wanted to get every bit of that light out, because it wasn't much. But when you build a fixture to actually illuminate the surface of the ground, reflector design harnesses all of that. And I'll go back to, in the old days, light bulbs generally put light out everywhere, okay? Any type of light was going everywhere. HID, same thing. So the most wasteful part of the old fixture was the reflector. Trying to get the light that's not going directly out to eventually get out required expensive reflective surfaces and such. But with that, you could harness 60% of your light and get it down to the ground. With what they're doing with, you know, I mean, I can't even understand how you build one of those acorn lights and sell it with a straight face. Because you're literally giving the consumer less than 30% of the output of that lamp is going to go on the ground. And most of it's going to go in your eye. And what did we say before? Put it in your eye, now you need 500% more light. So why do they sell acorn fixtures with 150-watt high-pressure sodium lamps in them? Because you have to get any measurable light on the ground. I mean, most of your light is going into your eyes. I mean, the bulk of light coming out of one of these fixtures is going horizontal. So if you're driving down the road, it goes right into your eye. So, I don't know what got me started on that, John.
I was asking what an acorn light was, because in my particular neighborhood, we had ones that are the size of a basketball. They're coated in white, and
those are actually globes. Those are just generic globes, and those are decorative lights. And what would be great is if they were just decorative. In the 60s, you know, just round globes, you know, sometimes two or three on a pole were modern looking. Yeah. And they usually put, you know, pretty small lights in them. They're bad, but they're not really designed to put much light out, so it's not terrible. The Washington Globe looks like...
I guess what I noticed was I was like you. I'd look up when walking into the house and I'd see four stars, and I took some walks in my neighborhood that didn't have those basketball globes, and I could see 20 or 30 stars because they didn't get the globe lights.
Exactly. Well, adaptation is what happens when you get a glare source and you're walking down or you're driving down the road. You could be in, there's three types of adaptation that your eye is possible, it's possible for your eye to do. One's called scotopic, which is what we consider night vision, okay? And that's when your rods are active and your cones really aren't. Cones allow you to see color, rods allow you to see, you know, black and white. On the opposite end of the spectrum, you have photopic vision, which is daylight vision or under bright lighting. Photopic vision is primarily using your cones. Okay, so you see color in that area with cones. You don't see it in rods. So for many, many years, everybody thought that the vision pretty much was this or that. You took 20 to 40 minutes to change. If you went into a darkened theater, you've all seen this. You walk in, you miss the beginning, there aren't any lights on, you stumble down the aisle because you can't see anything. It takes 20 to 30 minutes average to get your adaptation to something close to scotopic. In a movie theater, you're not going to get scotopic because you're looking at a bright screen. But if you walk out tonight out of the yurt and you walk down a path, in 30 minutes, you'll start getting your dark vision. But if you look at a bright light source, any bright light source, it can be white, it can be red, it can be amber, and you look at it long enough, you'll degrade your night vision. Mm-hmm. And so you'll start transitioning into something called mesopic, which is between the two. It actually is using a little bit of the cones and a lot of the rods, and it allows you what they call dual adaptation. And I have no idea how it got here. So in one of these, you have a point source of light that is putting out over 20,000 lumens of light. That's the smallest one you will get in one of these things. This thing, for instance, puts out about 600 lumens. So you've got a point source of light that is as bright as you should ever be looking at, and you're walking down or driving down, you glance up briefly, and it takes about 20 seconds to blow your night vision to the point where you're now photopic. Well, photopic's great if you have a lot of light out, but in between these horrible lights, it's dark. It's got shadows. It's got pedestrians crossing the road. And It's really tough if you're old. As you age, as your eye ages, what happens is it yellows. Your lens inside your eye changes from a clear fluid as a baby to a very yellow brownish lens as you age. And that really does another thing, is it reduces the quantity of light that's coming in. So older eyes can't see as well because they're not getting as much light. But even on top of that, it bounces glare around inside the lens two or three times before it gets to the back, which makes it really difficult. The aging eye is one of the worst situations because my mom stopped driving when she was about 60. She just felt unsafe. She couldn't drive at night, so she didn't drive. And she felt it was her fault. I'm not safe on the road, I can't drive, I'll stop. If you use quality outdoor lighting, you would not have any problem driving until you couldn't drive. But we design lights in this environment for cost. We reduce the cost down to the absolute minimum. So we'll put the cheapest fixture in, and we'll put farther away on poles so you have like nice dark and light areas. But I digress. The worst part about that is that it is just not designed to improve your visibility at all. It's designed to look good during the day. That's it. That's why I'm not being facetious when I tell people in cities that if you really like the look of it, put something like this in it. And it'll look just as nice. Actually, a glow looks kind of nice at night, and it doesn't degrade the vision as bad. But, no, I don't have to draw for
it. What about retrofitting acorn lights, Bob? Is there anything you can do to people to put them up? There's a shield for acorns.
We have talked to, you know, there's a great manufacturer that makes these internal shields that they're really cool, and I like them a lot. But you take this glass down, so anybody knows, this is how it's mounted. Got a pole, and there's some screws that hold this glass in, so when you relamp, you just pull the thing off, and you change the lamp, and you stick the thing back on. They made a shield for about $20 that when you have the globe out, the shield, it folds up like a tulip flower. I mean, it's this metallic-sized plastic, and it ends up, you know, being about this big, and it's about that tall, but it folds up like the petals of a flower. So your little neck down here, you shove the thing in, and then you flip it upside down, shake it once, and it lodges right in here. And so it makes it almost a fully shielded fixture. It usually doesn't go quite that far, so it will put in this internal shield, and it will cut off all that light going up in the air. It'll cut most of the light going into your eyes, and it will redirect that light down the ground. And the really scary part is, once you've done that, it's about 10 times brighter on the ground than it should be. Because they put all that light in, now it's all getting focused on the ground. So that's one of my problems, is you stick them in one of these fixtures, you instantly have...
You blot the ground.
Well, I mean, it's just massive amounts of light. But it's still better than that. I mean, it's better than the worst.
What about what John said about different bulb possibilities? The
problem with high pressure or HID lamps in general is they're matched to what's called a ballast. And the ballast is the electronics that allow a gas lamp to ignite and then go back down to its operating voltage. You have the same thing in fluorescent lights, which is smaller. So if you have a 150 watt version of this, you have a ballast that is the same match for that 150 watt. Can't put a 70 watt because you need a different ballast. And so if you go swapping the whole thing out, it's cheaper to buy a new light. And it's much better to buy a better light.
Or just turn the light off.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, something like this, you can get a really nice quality, you know, light. I was gonna look on, if we have some time, we can show you. I mean, we make great, excuse the art, bell fixtures. This is an arm, just a, you know, metal arm, you know, cap. Light is up here, shines down there. You don't have any glare. It's They make them looking colonial. You can make them look any way you want. They can make a carriage light, which, if you guys know, is a square panel with old-fashioned, what you actually had candles in during colonial times, and is for some reason very popular for outdoor lighting. And the problem is the light's right in the middle of that glass panel. Well, you can get these carriage lights with the light up in top inside of a, you know, shield like this. So the light source is up there, and instead of that, you've got the square panes of a carriage light. You can make good fixtures, and those don't cost any more. But once again, we get back to the fact that if there's no awareness whatsoever among the people buying lighting, then they will put up bad lighting because they're ignorant. And I mean, I'm not derogatorily, people that don't know anything about lighting should not be designing lighting, should not be buying lighting. But there's another discussion for another day. Okay, anything?
Other than telling them it saves money.
What's that?
When you're trying to convince them why to do it, other than saying it'll save money.
Well, that's a good thing. Now you can say, oh, by the way, replace this stuff with good LED lighting, and you're going to save 60, 70% of your energy, which is going to pay back that purchase within 10 years. Old-fashioned HID lights, we're about 10-year, you know, but, you know, that was over the previous generation, which is mercury vapor.
Other things that you find effective besides saving money, if someone says?
Improving visibility for the citizens. And I always hit government people hard on making it safe for the aging eye, because we have an aging population. And these people are driving to much older than they typically would have 50 years ago. And you have people out there that are having a hard time seeing. And they're having a hard time seeing because nobody knows how to design lighting. So when I tell people, municipalities in particular, it's like, you kind of have an obligation, if you're going to do it, to do no harm. I mean, it's just like a doctor. If you're going to design something, improve the situation, don't make it worse. All right, any more questions? Yeah.
The vast majority of the roadway lighting and street lighting are owned and operated by the utility companies.
Pretty much true within cities and counties, yes.
Yeah, and if you want different fixtures, you have to go to the utility companies. The utility companies aren't going to keep 50 different types of fixtures. So
you've talked to a utility company. I've heard that for about 10 years.
Yeah, so there's a limited list of what you can get through the utility company.
Yeah, and the problem is there's no logic to what's on that list. What is on the list is what they've done before, and there's no interest in many cities to change it. Certainly not to add to the SKU numbers, which is what they tell you they can't do because they have to stock these. They don't want to stock 20 items if they can stock 10 items. And I said, great, lose half of them, put in good shielded fixtures. I mean, where about in this process are we? 25 years since IDA started knocking on doors saying, you know, this is really bad. This lighting doesn't improve visibility, it wastes energy, and it's bad for the environment. And we still have utilities that say, oh yeah, but it's really cheap and we like that. I mean, you see what's called NEMA head barn lights. I mean, barn lights are what Virginia Power, if you say I want a light in my backyard, they'll come out and put a NEMA fixture. A NEMA fixture, well, it's just as bad as this. It's got a head. And then it has a plastic skirt. And the light typically hangs down under the skirt. And so you have 100%, well, not 100%. I'll take that. It shields 40% of the light going up, so it's putting it down. But if you go past Virginia Power, I want a light, that's what they'll offer. And they won't even offer that same model. Comes with an option for a Hubble shield. Hubble shield designed by Bubble manufacturing. It's a spun parabolic aluminum shield. Looks like this, just a lot bigger. Costs $50 more than a basic fixture. The problem is the basic fixture is only $75. So not even stocking another light. If they just had it with two options, it would allow the homeowner to get the light that they wanted. It would put everything on the ground. So you're right. The problem is Virginia Power, most utilities, don't have any interest in doing good lighting. They're not about good lighting. They're about selling electricity. And so the larger the light, the more glary, the more light you need, they sell more energy. So
where are they getting those, that stock from? That might be a moment to go.
Where are they getting what?
Who's supplying the utility company with those lights? The water lighting manufacturers now help doing something.
And that might be
another thing. Here's news. In the last, 25 years ago, 10% of outdoor lighting was shielded. Today, over 60% of the lighting fixtures sold are fully shielded, and that's because there is awareness. And what's really frustrating is the awareness just doesn't seem to be that great in cities. Okay, if you go out to the Southwest, you go out to California, the entire West Coast, you can't find anything with shielded outdoor lights anymore. They will not put up acorn lights. They have had an awareness of energy way beyond what we have, and they have had a basic awareness of the outdoors and the environment, so they care about that. It's in the cities and in very populated areas. You have a hard time getting power companies to get with the program. What it takes is somebody in the local government to tell them, we don't care about your stocking problems. We have to pay for it. Stock something we want. And I don't know, where are you from?
Fairfax County.
I live in Fairfax County, Fairfax Station. I happen to be, my company, utility is NOVEC, not Virginia Power. 10 years ago, NOVEC started stocking full cutoff fixtures. Now half of their inventory is full cutoff fixtures. And nobody forced them at gunpoint to do it. But somebody in there said, I kind of like to have an option for good lighting. So as a cooperative, they gave them all those options. Virginia Power, it's kind of, they know what's good for you. So that's what you get.
What are the other things?
Although you can get it from Virginia Power. You can get a full cutoff street light.
Yeah. And that's what the newer ones are installed. They don't take care of all the existing ones that are out there.
And you know, you can get them replaced.
Yes, you can.
You have to squeal a lot to a guy named Felix
Vermeer.
Yes. And I've had nice long talks with Felix. This guy, the guy, he'll help you out trying to get this done. The problem is, everybody that gets it done comes back later and says, well, they took out mercury vapor, which was barely putting any light, and yeah, it was a cobra. Now they put in a 70, 80 watt high pressure sodium, and it's really bright underneath because it's fully shielded. All the light is being directed down the ground. The light typically becomes 4 to 5 times brighter than it was.
Well, it's more efficient too because
they went from 150 down to 70.
Right, and the mercury vapor lights are dimming over age as well. So
you gotta love mercury vapor. It never burns out. It just loses its light and uses the same amount of energy. Typically, there are lights out there that have been out there 20 years, and the lamp still will put out some light. Not much more than this, right, but it still puts out some light.
But the other thing you have to find is what do people want? Like in the revitalization areas, they want the acorn lights for the looks. And in Reston, they want the metal halide lights for the looks.
The good news is, in Fairfax County, you can no longer just buy for the looks. In Fairfax County, you need a special permit to put in non-full cutoff lighting. Okay? That's something that happened with Fairfax's ordinance 7 years ago. You still see bad lighting coming in, but mainly it's decorative. Okay, it's in pedestrian areas and places where they had to have bad lighting, so they went and got the permit. And unfortunately, Fairfax County will give you the permit if you cry loud enough. And,
right, but that's for buildings, that not necessarily for street lighting.
Street lighting has to be full cutoff. And so you will tell me if you find anything that's not. That's why Felix will put in a a full cup of light when they're replacing.
So they're putting in acorns.
Well, acorns are
right revitalization area.
It will.
Bailey's Crossroads and Field.
Bailey's Crossroads incorporates city. I mean, this is my problem. Well, I mean, what you do is you see a lot of places like Fairfax City that don't have to, they don't have to abide by those rules, so they put in that.
But the other thing is when you light, you have to light according to federal standards.
No, you do not. This is something they'll tell you.
Well, we've been sued in the past if it does not.
Well, here's the deal. There are no federal standards, which is really bad. There is something called a recommended practice. And recommended practice is by the Illuminating Engineering Society of America. It is the Bible, as far as most municipalities are concerned. Felix will quote it book and verse when he tells you why he won't do something. Because for the last 20, 30, 40 years, they have been promoting more light is better, and glare doesn't matter. I mean, you can sum up all their standards pretty much like that. So there is no maximum illumination value. There's only a minimum illumination value. So if you want to know how bright to make that parking lot, they'll tell you how bright it has to be, but they won't tell you where to stop because more is better. And glare, who cares? I mean, it's roadways, streets, everything. It's kind of like you're up to, you know, do whatever you want. So as far as what do you have to light to? Most municipalities today light to several standards. IES is one of them. The other one is by, there's another green sort of group now that's using energy efficiency as their standards. And you would think they're better, but they're actually not much better. But generally speaking, the only time you can be sued successfully, that doesn't mean that somebody can't sue you, is if you're negligent in either your maintenance or your design. So if you put in lighting that caused an accident because it made a dark spot or something like that, somebody could sue you. But if you don't put the lighting in, you can't be sued because there isn't any requirement that you light. There is a requirement that when you put the light in, it be well designed, and that if you put it in, you have to keep the bulbs in it. You can't let them burn out, because if you had an accident in a crosswalk where the lights are out, every lawyer will line up for that, because that's an easy lawsuit. To the best of my knowledge, in 50 plus years, there's never been a successful lawsuit for not having light. It's just, if you have a maintenance issue, something like that.
Well, how do you change that government standard Bible book?
Well, it's not a government standard. It's called Recommended Practices by a standards group that has put together these because there are no federal standards. I mean, even if you go to highway lighting standards, they defer to recommended practices. They don't sell. How do you change it?
You
change
said the recommended
awareness?
Practices are not.
I'm sorry?
You said the recommended. What they recommend is not.
They're getting better. I mean, we've been working with them for the last 10 years. We developed something called the Model Lighting Ordinance, which has been 7 years in the works. We passed it last year, this time, and it is the first template that any municipality can use to create their own lighting ordinance without spending a year. Okay? In the old days, if you wanted a lighting ordinance, you really had to want it, because you even had to have a motivated volunteer from IDA or somebody to come in and help, and you need to know about lighting. And those two things don't typically happen in a municipal government. So it's not the fact that some wanted them but did not have the ability to write them themselves. So when we started working with the IES, it was a real uphill battle, because IES's mantra has always been more light makes you safer. I mean, that's what they've been pushing. So for us to come up with an ordinance that says use just the right amount of light only when you need it and only as long as you need it, use curfews and things like that, was kind of a battle. So it only took 7 years to get that, but we got that done. Now a community can basically pick this up, put in what type of community population they have, because there's things called environmental zones. You start with zone zero, which is here. This would be a zone zero, a very natural, pristine area. And you go up to zone four, which would be Times Square. So you define what your population density is, which defines your area, and that kind of defines how much light you allow. And there's a great thing called lumen budget. You have a total number of lumens that you can use to light a parcel of property. And you can put it all in this corner and go dark over there, but you can't overlight your whole property. You get a budget, you use it efficiently, and you can do as much lighting as is necessary to meet these RP standards. So that helps us communicate to communities that they need to use lighting efficiently. It also plays into something called energy standards, which have been in place for 20 years, but have really taken off in the last decade. California started it with something called Title 24. And they had lumen budgets, and they cranked them to be more and more stringent every year. It's not just outdoor lighting, it's indoor lighting. And now there are two or three competing standards. Every state in the union, except for four or five, has adopted them. And as they get more and more strict, you are going to see lighting levels reduced because they can't get them in the budget. They can't squeeze that much light in. So that's good news. It'll still take about a decade to really make impact, but it's working. Standards, yeah, awareness. If people know there are alternatives, they'll consider them. I have never had a municipal designer, somebody that's required to do this, get this information and then say, oh no, I want to keep going at the same time. They typically have never looked at it, they've never thought about it. All right, anything else? Hold on, Tom. Is that an hour? All right. What I want to do is talk to you about what we've done at the National Parks. When we started the process 2 years ago, we went out and did a basic survey of 9 national parks. And some of them were really famous, some of them were really small and not so famous. And the quality of lighting within them varied dramatically. But the majority of national parks are lit by the maintenance person, and their source is Home Depot. They go down and they look for the cheapest light they can possibly find, and they buy 20 or 30 of them at a time. So they go out and buy twin parks a lot. So twin par fixtures are about $10 minus the lamps, and they can be pointed down, they can be pointed up. Generally speaking, they point them out so that they get as much area as they can light. They also are, you know, unshielded. They have glare. When you walk up on one, you can't see what's underneath them because the light is coming directly at you. So that was one of the first things we addressed. Can you fix that kind of lighting without replacing every fixture in the national parks, because that's expensive. And we did. We found that, okay, if you got a twin par fixture, you pull one out, plug the hole where the other one was, and you direct that thing straight down, and keep the motion sensor if it's got it, and you can put something like this. These are amber LED fixtures, and or lamps, and they have what we're calling the most ecologically neutral, or doesn't impact the ecology. And the reason is twofold. Amber is in an area of visibility in your eye, slightly off of red. Red is your eye is least sensitive to red. It doesn't focus well, and it also needs more of it to be able to see the same level as you would with white light. Amber is somewhere in between, and what's great is that it also doesn't attract insects. Invertebrates, flying insects, are killed by the billions every year, and nobody sheds a lot of tears for mosquitoes, but along with mosquitoes are moths and other beneficial invertebrates that are attracted to white light. They basically, once they've been attracted to it, cannot get their bearings again, and they spend their time circling it until they lose their energy and die. So if you look underneath these lights and miniature parts, every couple of days they have to come through and sweep up the thousands of dead insects that have gone underneath them. So we've been able to retrofit a twin bar fixture just by putting it in like that. Taking that fixture, locking the one socket straight down, sticking it in, becomes a full cutoff fixture. This is a 8-watt amber LED. It puts out about 400 lumens, okay, which is more than enough for most lighting. In some cases, what we found is these NEMA fixtures. And NEMA fixtures are using a medium screw base, high intensity, either mercury vapor, high pressure sodium, or metal halide lamp. That's going through a ballast. It's usually mounted 20 feet in the air. And with some experimentation, you can't do this with any other light, so don't try it. But LED lighting typically comes in a voltage range of 100 to 200, 120 to 220. It also is very insensitive to voltage surges and fluctuation. So we've been able to go into NEMA heads, these really horrible overhead glare bombs, take out the lamp, put in, this is the, NEMA usually has a mobile screw base, a larger threaded, and you can basically just stick this in there and then stick typically the larger one and screw it in. You don't have to take the ballast out, and you instantly turn it into a full cutoff light. It's about $30. And if you really want to do it well and you have an electrician, you can bypass the ballast. Now allow greater efficiency because the ballast sucks a little bit of juice, and it also is the item that will fail. And when it fails, then this is going to stop working too. But in the national parks, we've gone through and retrofit over 109 parks with these. And these cost about $35. And they now can have lights that are 20 feet in the air, putting about a foot candle on the ground, which is about what you need in a darkened environment. Because the other thing we've tried to educate national parks about is they aren't Walmarts. Okay? If you are in a city and you have a parking lot lit like the recommended practices say, it will end up being 3 to 5 foot candles on the ground. And in an environment where you have bright lights everywhere and your vision is photopic most of the time, you need a little more light just to be able to see from your car maybe. But out in the middle of a national park, what you want to do is maintain your dark adaptation as long as you possibly can. So if you're in a campground and there's a visitor center, and the visitor center or the restrooms are lit like they're in a city, then not only are they going to be a beacon for wildlife, for insects, they're going to be a source of glare, and they're also going to instantly make you lose your dark adaptation. So when you stumble out of that visitor center or the restroom, you have to have a flashlight to be able to see where you're going, because your eyes will take that 20 to 30 minutes to adapt. We've tried to, and I think we're going to come out with standards in the next month that will change the way national parks do the lighting. And they'll start lighting to a much, much lower lighting level. In most cases, a 20th of the lighting level that has been used in the past. And so we're talking 0.2 foot candles is a standard as opposed to 2 to 4 foot candles. So when they do that, they are going to save massive amounts of energy. When you're talking about lighting with 13 watts of LED, replacing 100 to 150 watt metal halide or high pressure sodium fixture, that's substantial. When we went through the visitor center at Bryce Canyon, we went one better. The genius that designed the lighting around the visitor center took what's called a wall pack, which if you know is something that you can mount on the side of the building, cheap. And they decided to put them, these were kind of flush mounted,
and they mount it in the wall around the visitor center. It's a half wall at this time. So they mounted these things that were designed to be 20 feet high. They mounted them at 1 foot. And they had the same lamp in them that they would have put in them at 20 feet. And it put 1,600 foot candles on the sidewalk. And what was really great, it was concrete. So it acted like a reflector. So you bounce 1,600 foot candles of light off the sidewalk, and they only had 24 of these, 2,400 watt metal halide fixtures, lighting the pathway going up to the visitor center. When they turned them on, you could see the place, no lie, over a mile away. It looked like a spaceship landing. I mean, it just bounced this light unbelievably. So when we went in, we started looking at, well, what can we do? These are really expensive fixtures, and they were actually mortared in place, so you can't replace them easily. But what we did, we said, well, what's the purpose of it? I mean, that's when you get back to lighting. What was this supposed to be doing? It's supposed to be illuminating the sidewalk so you can get up to a lighted environment in the visitor center. It wasn't designed so you could read a newspaper or do surgery during the sidewalk. So we've developed these 3 watt yellow, amber LEDs with a metal halide fixture. Like I told you, you can stick one of these in it. You don't even have to bypass the ballast. You just screw it in. If it needs an adapter, you put an adapter. We took out the ballast and bypassed all the ballast in these things and put 3 watt amber LEDs in these. We reduced the energy in each of those things by quick do the math. I mean, 100 watt metal halide down to 3 watts. There's 24 of them. And we figured it out, it'll save $1,000 a year in just that one retrofit. That's $1,000 I think we use for more fixtures, paid staff, or whatever. And it looks great. You come into it and it puts a glow on all the sidewalk. You see the walls going up. You're walking up. You're not looking at any glare anymore because these things are unbelievable. And you're walking up. You see the lights inside the visitor center. So that was just one retrofit. But as we went through the park, we came up with the worst, with the things that happen the most often are called jelly jars on the side of a building. And you see them on every house. It's a $4 fixture, which is why there are one every house. It has something that looks like a glass globe underneath of it, and it screws in usually, and it looks like an old-fashioned jelly jar. Now they're plastic, you can squeeze them, they're not quite as elegant as they used to be, but they're still $4. And if you stick one of these in a jelly jar, it's gonna be mounted like that. And that's not bad. I mean, it's not putting a lot of light out this way. Most of the light's going out that way. It'll put a really nice diffused light on the sidewalk or the stairs. But if you're really dark adapted and you come up on one of these things, it's really bright. That glare from this light actually will change your dark adaptation. So we decided to look at an alternative. This is called a PAR 16. This is the smallest package we could get. And it is also 3 watts, but instead of 3 watts of diffused lighting, it's a instantaneous conversion to a full cutoff light. No light above the horizon, no glare. 3 watts is compared to typically, if they're incandescent, 60 watts. If they've got a high, this was what we found the most of, which is about 13 watts. So it only reduced the energy consumption by 75%. But We ordered 300 of these, and we put these in jelly jars all across the park surface. And mainly, we've turned out we removed the globes. The globes, you can put them back on, but they actually bounce light around. And they also keep this hotter, so there's not a lot of value to it, unless the aesthetics are important. So the last couple ones we got, I'm going to show you what... This is state-of-the-art white LED. We use this where we have to. This is 8 watts. But there's something called color temperature. And LED starts, white LEDs start as blue LEDs, okay? It's a, they do something called phosphor conversion. So inside the actual LED itself, it starts out as a blue LED and then it coats it with a phosphor. And that phosphor radiates light, okay? And the better the phosphor, the more it radiates a white across the spectrum as opposed to a really big spike in what's called blue and yellow spectrum. Blue light, your eye is incredibly sensitive to it. It will actually cause burns on your retina. I'll turn this on. And it basically, we found that it does an amazing thing. There's in your eye, besides for your cones and your rods, behind the retina, not in the retina, there's something called a photoganglion cell. And you gotta love science. We didn't know about this until less than a decade ago. This is something that was recently discovered. And the sole purpose of this cell is to tell you when it's night or day. And it's not a visual, it's not something that improves your vision in any way, but it happens to be at 460 nanometers right in the blue peak, okay? And what it's designed to do is tell your bodily systems, your hormonal systems, I'm sleepy, I'm going to go to sleep. When the blue goes away, you become sleepy, okay? It makes you alert in the morning by looking at blue light. If you look at a bright blue sky, you will become alert much quicker than if it was a cloudy overcast day. And when you live in climates like Alaska, you have seasonal affective disorder, SAD. That's because you're not getting enough blue light to balance your metabolism. There's something that happens really great at night. As you change and you start producing something called melatonin. Melatonin first makes you drowsy, but it also helps cure cellular damage. So the more melatonin that's secreted at night, the more your body can repair its damage. And one of the things it does is reduce and inhibit tumor growth. So you could have a tumor as long as you're getting a good cycle of day, night. It will actually inhibit the growth of that tumor to the point that it may not grow up and may not metastasize. But if you take away melatonin by basically never getting dark, at night you're living under a lit environment, you're staring at a TV screen or a computer screen that has a lot of blue light that happens to be exactly 460 nanometers. That's the peak. Because the cruel irony is the LED that excites phosphor the most is at 460 nanometers. So all the white LED being produced is being produced in a way that will make your body think it's daytime. Okay, so it will inhibit at night. So when you go to bed, if you were staring at the computer screen right up until the time you go to sleep, it'll take your body a full 40 minutes to an hour to just get drowsy, because it takes that long for your body to realize it's no longer day. So keep in mind, if you can keep warmer color LED, this is 3000 Kelvin, 3000 K, that's called CCT. And that is a way of, it's a metric for color temperature. This is below 2000. This is actually a very, very warm. It's not white light, it's yellow light. And the street lights that are going in, by and large, are 5000 K CCT. Very, very blue white light. In your home, anything more, this is a 3K, anything more than this is crazy. Because this is what we used to call cool white light. This is what, when fluorescent came out, everything was this white. And then over time, we've done more and more versions of it to the point where your typical CFL today is probably around 2,500 or 2,200, which is a more yellow light and it's more pleasing. It's more like incandescent light. So it also doesn't have as much blue. This doesn't have as much blue as that. And these have no blue whatsoever. And what we're doing in the national parks goes beyond what you need to worry about in your home, is that we don't want to disrupt the habitat. If you put a white light up, it can be seen at much greater distances. And if it is seen, you will attract animals. Not just mosquitoes, not just moths. You will attract bears, you will attract deer, you will attract animals that will change their predation patterns. They will eat things that they didn't eat before. A, because they can see them. In the dark, a mouse had a pretty good chance of surviving animals. If you light up the surrounding environment, they're going to be eaten, and they're going to be eaten in mass quantities because owls now have an advantage. Other animals that couldn't see at all can now see. They change their patterns to match the environment we build. If we build one that's lit in the middle of nowhere, we have to know there's a lot of unintended consequences. We're going to see mating patterns change. They've had studies where birds that live under lit environments get up early and stay up late. They have less energy. They don't mate because they have longer days. They do not rest. Bats go out of their way, in some cases, to feed around a light. It becomes a smorgasbord, or some bats go out of their way to avoid it. And when they go out of their way, they have to travel much more distance to get to a place to feed. They feed, but they get less energy because they usually are going back to wherever they nest. So they lose body weight. They don't mate anymore because the female doesn't reach a body mass that needs to be. So everything we do in the natural environment has effects. We just need to care. And a lot of people now are starting to care about the unintended ecological impact of lighting at night. We hope that the standards we come out with for the next month will promote the use of amber LED and use it with only full cutoff and only the intensity necessary in the national parks. If we do this, we can at least make it better in those protected areas. I don't know that we'll ever change the world to amber LED because the genie is out of the bottle. Most people have felt that high intensity discharge lamps have never been a color that they liked. When it started out, mercury vapor was very green. Nobody liked it. They changed it over to high pressure sodium. It started very yellow and nobody liked it. Then it became pinkish as it got better. Still nobody likes it. And then they came out with metal halide, which is a very white light, which you see in most parking lots today. And people love it because it's just like outside, according to today's people. And they like white light. And the problem is, with LED, we now can have it outdoors. This, you know, this color, IEDA is just pushing now to try to maintain no higher than 3,000 K. Because the 5,000 K is so blue that it will change the environment as we know. It will change to the point where it will be much harder for species, animals, to have a natural night. Because if they're putting out blue-white light into the environment, and you're close to a lit environment, you will never have dark. As far as the eye is concerned, you're always going to be in daylight. And that, I am afraid, will have really massive unintended consequences. And it's like DDT. We won't know it for 10 or 20 years after it's been in the environment because this doesn't happen overnight. You don't change the technology. By the time you change it, it's really too late. I mean, your way of resolving the situation requires removing it from the environment, which Won't people love that after they've installed billions of LED lights to find out 10 years later that all they had to do was try to control the color temperature a little bit and shield it and use all the light up in the unit? You could have it the way you needed it and kept it for another 50 years. Well, I don't have much else. I appreciate your attention, yeah.
Just one question. Where can a consumer go and buy light bulbs like those? For example, guidance on what to buy?
Hopefully, in the near future from IDA. These have been made specially. They're not available. You can get these with white LEDs pretty much anywhere. So if you're looking for just a good, fully shielded white light, I can give you a place to go. They're about $16. Okay, in single quantity. We've been able to get some of these made as cheap as $6 or $7. The quality is a little bit different. These are what we're using for the national parks because we don't want them to come apart. But the same LEDs inside, the same quantity of light. This cost us $3. Depends on the fixture you've got and the color that you want. You can get this light, or this light, the white LED at Home Depot. That's 8 watts. That's probably more than you need, but you can get it. It's about $20. You can't get amber LED. We are trying now to talk several manufacturers that are carrying them, making them available, and they keep telling us, show us the money. And we keep saying, well, that's kind of chicken before the egg. We can't promote them if they're not available. And as of right now, the deal we've struck is it will make them for you if you sell them. If you find the outlet, we will sell. But we don't really want to cram it down our distributor's throat because they're not going to understand it. So we have to do two things. We have to get national parks to generate the volume of these amber LEDs, and we also have to raise the awareness among consumers that, you know, my daughter will test, we have amber LED around our house. It's really nice, but it's really unusual. I mean, people walk up.
We have amber LED inside the house, which is not nice.
Only when we test it. Inside the house is an R&D lab. Outside, I've been using it for the last 2 years because we've been developing these things, partially to test them to see how they're going to hold up, but partially because no insects. I mean, I've always liked bug lights, but a CFL bug light, which is about that color, attracts many more insects than amber LED. This is a very narrow bandwidth. Instead of looking like this on a spectrum, it looks like this. It's a very straight thing. And that's why it's also good for night vision. It doesn't disrupt as much of your compounds as a light.
Do I recall correctly that you're planning to install some of the LEDs here?
Yeah, I brought a whole bunch of these and these, and we're going to talk to TMI about retrofitting them, maybe even today.
I said something to him about the fluorescent lights that were in the kitchen, and he said if we'd have known that, he has sleeves for this.
Yeah,
amber sleeves.
Inside the restrooms, it's curious, inside the restrooms of the national parks, there's actually more glare and light trespass being produced into the campgrounds than any of the outdoor lighting because they light them so that it's very bright inside. And that causes two things. One, when you walk in, you're blinded, and then when you walk out, you can't see anything. But it also, the glare sometimes, you know, can be seen 100 yards away. It puts out so much light because all these things end up having windows so that you can have natural light. What we've done in there is change the lamps in the fluorescent fixtures to bug lights, which you can get them. They're pretty expensive, but it's an amber light. And you can then put a sleeve on it that's called a neutral density filter, and you can dial it down from transparent to 80%. So we can basically, by turning the sleeve around, adjust the light level, and then we adjust it down to 0.2 foot candles. So without replacing the fixtures, you can slip a sleeve over and or you can put a yellow sleeve over. So maybe next trip. Any other questions?
Bob, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hopefully around the yurts and stuff, you'll be able to see these in action, so you'll get a feel for A, how pleasant it is, B, how you can keep your garment action, so see if you can see them. All right, next slide.